All aboard!
My name is Henriette von Schirach, and I want to tell you the story of my life. So many things happened to me that if I hadn't been there, I would not believe them myself. As I look back, I realize there are some things a person doesn't like to tell about themselves, unless they are pretty close to the grave, so to speak. Now I want to tell the truth. The whole truth, within limits. You see, truth is a very valuable thing, and I believe we should be a little economical with it.
As the noise starts round, I stop loud, thou kneel, as silent servant, and as silent agent, to thee the Deutschland von Parteiergriffen.
I was only about 8 years old when Adolf Hitler came to power in Germany. At first, we loved our Führer. It was because of him that we had clothes to wear and food to eat. Suddenly, we had prosperity after years of hardship. I joined the Hitler Youth and made lots of new friends. I received special training in so many things, and soon I was winning many merit badges. We all fell under his spell. We loved him freely and with great enthusiasm. He was like a father to us. He had such blue eyes, but also he had very bad breath. But of course, no one was brave enough to tell him. In my early 20s, I was invited to the Berghof, the Führer's Alpine Fortress. It was there that I actually first shook hands with our great leader and met Eva Braun. It was a magical time. I was invited on expensive vacations with Eva and the Braun family. Eva told me all her secrets. She complained that the Führer kept her as his secret girlfriend. She had to pretend to be just one of his many secretaries. "I am married to Germany," he would tell her. There was no intimacy. Eva told me she tried everything to get the Führer to pay attention to her. One time, I told her how everyone envied her. And she replied, "I'm just a bird in a golden cage." She loved posing for pictures. She loved showing off her body to us girls. There was always a movie camera recording all our fun. We would play act in her home movies, pretend to be spies or secret agents for the Fatherland. At first, I went along with the role-playing. It all got a bit kinky. It all got a bit bizarre. But I began to feel more and more uncomfortable. So, I was relieved when I met my future husband. He worked as Hitler's personal photographer. We were so honored when we were allowed to be married, high up in the clouds at the Führer's mountaintop retreat, the Eagle's Nest. Eva arranged everything. She celebrated my wedding like it was her own. And best of all, the Führer even agreed to be our best man. We felt so privileged, it was unbelievable. As the war progressed, things changed. Munich, where I lived, was placed under martial law. My Jewish friends started to disappear in the middle of the night. I learned later that a general called Rudolf Müller was the one mainly responsible for all these atrocities. So many people were being taken from their homes and packed onto freight trains like so many cattle. It was horrifying what was going on in our country. I knew that our Führer must not have known about these terrible things. I felt it was up to me to tell him what was happening. My friend Traudl Junger, who was actually Hitler's personal secretary, was there and remembered the time when I confronted the Führer.
Die Henriette von Schirach hat ihn plötzlich gesagt, mein Führer, ich habe da in Wien am Bahnhof einen Zug mit deportierten Juden gesehen. Das war so entsetzlich und das ist also so schauerlich, wie die behandelt werden. Wissen Sie davon und erlauben Sie das? Und dann hat der Hans gesagt, ja, der Führer ist aufgestanden und hat gesagt, irgend sowas wie Gefühlsduselei oder mischen Sie sich nicht in Dinge, die Sie nicht verstehen? Und hat sich zurückgezogen, hat den Abend also abgebrochen und seitdem ist die Frau von Schirach nie mehr auf den Berghof eingeladen worden.
After that, I never saw Eva again. A few days later, the Gestapo turned up at our home and took all the photos and negatives that my husband had taken of Eva. Some of them were very intimate. One film even showed Eva completely naked. Soon after, they sent my poor husband to the Russian front. Eva could be so spiteful, and she may have arranged my husband's removal. All I can say for sure, someone in power sent my husband to Stalingrad, where Germany suffered its first great defeat. Over a quarter of a million men suffered from starvation and frostbite and death. My husband was one of the many, many thousands who never returned. When the Allies started bombing our cities, I lost my mother and father, along with the lovely apartment we had lived in. It was then that I almost had a total mental breakdown. Thankfully, my uncle, who had escaped to the south of Italy, took me in. It was as far away from the war as I could get, or so I thought.
Thank you. General! General! Are you all right? We must get you out of here. Okay. Okay, easy now. I take care of you.
Was losing the war. Mussolini had been strung up by his fellow Italians, and following Hitler's example, his fanatical followers like Goering and Himmler and many more fanatical Nazis had killed themselves. But Rudolf Müller, our former town marshal, decided that suicide was a poor use of his talents. He rounded up what was left of his staff, plundered the city coffers, and set off for Argentina. It's funny how things turn out. I had traveled hundreds of kilometers to get away from the war, and the man I dreaded the most, the Beast of Munich, is here. He is in my front yard.
Halt! I'll fire!
I was in total disbelief.
That was just a warning shot. Please help me, he's dying.
Bring him this way. He looks badly wounded. You should get him to a doctor. I have very little medicine for such terrible wounds.
Can you help him? Please.
He cannot be moved for at least 2 or 3 days.
We can't stay here behind enemy lines.
I do not care one way or the other, but if you move him, he will die.
Get prepared. Yeah, listen. You must get to where.
I don't know what the general whispered to the corporal, or what they were being so secretive about. Although, naturally, I had my suspicions. I did know that when the corporal brought those weapons into my uncle's house, this would mean trouble for me.
Thank you for helping. As soon as the general is well, we'll be on our way. The enemy must not find him.
I
put your flag
up for you, General. I was horrified when they hung up that flag, which has come to symbolize all that is wrong with German justice, especially the courtroom of Judge Roland Riesler.
Heil!
After the attempt to kill Hitler, thousands of people were rounded up. My uncle was tortured until he confessed. Then he went before Judge Friesler. They humiliated my uncle. He had to hold his trousers up as they took away his belt. Then they hung him. In those days, nobody was safe. I have seen friends who put white flags in the windows of their homes and have been murdered by the Nazi death squads for surrendering to the Allies. But if you cooperated with the Germans, the partisans would murder you. It was a horrifying time to live. I had to think of something to make these Germans leave. You know, of course, that this area is constantly patrolled by Allied soldiers, don't you?
Yes, I know this.
Why do you not give yourself up to the Americans?
I cannot.
It seemed no matter what I said, the corporal was not going to leave. Eventually, I resorted to small talk. You remember Kurt Hutter?
Oh, yes. I knew him. He has a girlfriend, Heidi, right?
That's right.
Oh, she was big and fat.
Here. This looks like the spot, man.
Someone was in a hurry.
They didn't try very hard to hide the bodies.
This is the spot where the pilot spotted them, but where are they?
Most Germans are surrendering nowadays. Unless, of course, they're war criminals. Well, I guess that's why they took off. Okay, you guys, let's move out.
Although these men looked like American soldiers, they were actually a collection of misfits taken from all the Allied armies. Some were thieves, some rapists, deserters, or even murderers. They were given a choice to fight or face serious jail time, or even the firing squad. They were sort of a dirty dozen. They had started this mission with over 50 men and had been surprisingly effective, but many had been killed or wounded, and now there was only a few left. It was really considered a suicide squad. The British Spitfire pilot, who had shot up the German vehicle, tipped off the Americans as to where it could be found. Rumor had it that Albert Speer was making his escape through Italy, and it might have been him. In fact, any of the major Nazi war criminals would have been a great prize for these men.
You figure they might stop up the road away?
Maybe, if their wounded needs help bad enough.
The leader of the squad was Sergeant Michael Riley, who served with the Australian Army in the Middle East. Field Marshal Rommel had called them the Rats of Tobruk because of their fighting spirit and their refusal to surrender. Eventually, Riley managed to stow away on a Libyan ship out of the port of Alexandria and ended up in London. Because of the food shortages and rationing, Riley made a fortune selling stolen army supplies on the black market. Riley then used those funds to start a nightclub. Riley employed attractive but desperate young women as dancers to entertain the troops. With trainloads of red-blooded Americans flooding into England and Europe, there was a tremendous thirst for entertainment. Riley's club turned out to be a front for a high-class brothel, and the ladies were expected to do far more than just dance for the soldiers. One of Riley's girls was found dead in a back alley. She had been gang-raped and then strangled to death. Riley, in his fury, beat one of the soldiers who did it to death with his bare hands and put several more of his friends in hospital. It was enough to put Michael Riley before a firing squad on charges of murder and deserting his post. At the last moment, General Eisenhower offered to commute his sentence if Riley would agree to use his considerable skills at killing and head up a squad of men to hunt down the fanatical Nazis that still refuse to surrender.
Have you no husband?
I lost my husband in the invasion.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right. We were only married 3 weeks before he had to go away. We hardly knew each other. I still wasn't sure if this man drinking wine in my kitchen was a fanatical Nazi or just a soldier following orders. Now, you better let me bathe your wound.
Oh, it is nothing.
Those Krauts are long gone, Sarge.
They got wheels and one foot. No way we can catch up with them now.
The war's almost over.
Yeah,
I could do some gone, Sarge.
The Germans have lost.
Settle down. Settle down, men.
Let them go.
I'm almost out of ammo, Sarge.
Well, how does it look?
It seems quite.
Corporal Frank Kirby had been a highly decorated officer before being demoted and sent to the punishment squad. In one action, he had single-handedly killed 15 German soldiers and wounded many more. Under normal circumstances, he might have added another medal to his growing collection. Except on this occasion, one of the dead soldiers turned out to be the son of a local Bürgermeister, who insisted that his son and his men had surrendered under the protection of a white flag. Things might have ended there for Corporal Kirby, except the brass took into account that he had lost two of his three brothers to German sniper fire only a few days after this photograph was taken. Then Kirby vanished. They found him in Paris with a call girl.
Okay, Kirby, put your clothes on. You're coming with us.
The MPs found him and took him away to stand trial. Under oath at his court-martial, Kirby was given the chance of showing remorse, which might have afforded him some leniency. But when asked if he was sorry, he looked directly at the judge and said,
"Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I ran out of bullets."
Okay, you guys, let's move out.
I was sorry to hear that you too have lost your family. This war, it has brought so much suffering. Now that I've cleaned you up a bit, I can't see any injuries. I can see your wound, but I can't see anything serious. It might be someone else's blood.
It's a pity you live alone here. You must get lonely.
By this stage, I had known so much sadness and horror. I know my fellow Germans would hang me for surrendering to the Allies, and the Italian partisans would shoot me for collaborating with the Germans. So what the hell? You might as well take your pleasure where you can.
Well? Are you coming? You can leave the gun.
So easy to judge, but when your life is at stake, you would be surprised what you are willing to do. It seems this soldier was not going to leave. I had to find some way to convince him to go. You use whatever you have available, if it means you survive.
I wonder if anything's going on in there.
It's just a run-down farm.
I want the machine gun set up over there. Fan out and keep low. No point in tipping them off.
Let's leave them in peace.
I want the BAR over there.
Did I mention I was low on ammo, Sarge?
Those Germans are probably in South America by now.
Stay put until we see what's what.
Come on, Sarge, there's nothing in there. Let's get back to base.
I'm not taking any chances. Besides, I'm following orders. Now, Fearless, do you think you can check out that house without getting killed?
Sure, Sarge. Now, boys, don't shoot me in the back by mistake.
Cover him, you guys.
As a woman, I have often wondered why men go to war. I mean, why do they do it? They leave their farms, factories, and their families, and risk everything. What do they get out of it? So many will return home, crippled, shell-shocked, unable to cope. Some will even commit suicide. The best they can hope for is to return home in one piece.
Okay, men, move out, move out.
For these young men who came here today to trample through my uncle's farm, there would be no glory, or medals, or welcome home parades. By the end of this day, most of these young American boys will be dead.
Nelson, get the radio.
Never leave the radio.
Sorry about that.
What really happened here today will never be known. For the sake of their families, it is probably best that they never find out. Had I known what was going on, I might have been able to stop it. But I was too distracted. Making love, not war. I hope you know I don't normally do this sort of thing. I'm a shy girl.
Oh, yes. I can see that.
A very shy girl.
Before the war, I planned to be a priest.
The short time the corporal and I had together was magical. For a fleeting moment, we forgot about the war. I injected the general with his own morphine, which completely knocked him out. Seeing him so badly wounded and helpless, I couldn't bring myself to turn them in to the Italian partisans. The corporal surprised me in so many ways. He could be silly. He'd pull pranks on me.
All right, if I wash my claws.
The Germans are not really known for our humor. He made me laugh. I was amazed when he shared their secret escape plans. He told me the general had connections with a bishop at the Vatican named Alios Hudal, who, for the right price, could get them false papers and smuggle them to the Italian port of Genoa. The corporal revealed to me that a special German submarine was already on its way to pick them up. He said I could go along, even though it was only for the top German brass, who intended to continue the struggle from Argentina. I know pillow talk made by a man in the bedroom isn't always binding. Sadly, I was never to find out if his promise was true.
It's to our future. Together, okay?
Here, take the Thompson. You're going to have to get close.
Keep your head down, boy. Stay low. Stay low.
Krauts!
Open fire! Fire!
his head.
Corman! Corman! On his head!
Over here, Georgie! Yeah, yeah, yeah!
How bad is it, Doc?
Just grazed him. Is he okay?
Come on, Bob.
I'm okay.
That's it.
Boy.
Put this
just
on.
Just graze me, I guess.
Keep your head put down.
Get the second floor window!
We don't have to clean out these krauts. Our guys are overdue for some furlough.
It was rumored German brass are headed this way.
We can get on the radio and have a couple of fresh squads up here in 2 hours. 3 at most.
We can't wait that long.
Unbelievable. Just goddamn unbelievable.
Kirby, take Nelson and Thomas. And join Fearless on the left flank there. I'll take Regan around the right flank. That way we'll have the crowds in a crossfire. Okay, Regan, let's go.
I need more ammo.
How much ammo you got?
2 clips. Kirby, what's going on? Is the sergeant after a chest full of metal?
Yeah, could be. Listen, get on the radio and get some help up here.
Klondike, do you hear me? This is Blue Fox, over. I repeat, this is Blue Fox, over. Requesting backup. Klondike, do you hear me? Repeat, we need immediate assistance.
You're getting through?
I got nothing.
Keep trying.
Klondike, do you read me, over?
Can you take over the radio from Nelson?
This is Blue Fox.
I'm making a run at the
over.
Left flank.
Requesting backup.
Come with
Pull
me.
In.
Leave it. Come with me. I've got a job for you.
I'm right behind you.
Come on! Come on! Get over here! Leave him! He's gone! Come on! Come on! Come on! No, get down! Don't stand up, you idiot! God, man, that was close. Nelson, you've got a good arm. You think you can land a couple of grenades in the house from here?
Sure, Kirby, sure.
Don't worry, boy. We got you covered.
Kirby,
this kraut sticks his head up, he's a goner.
Kirby, I'm down to one mag. How much have you got?
Hell, buddy, I'm down to 1 or 2 rounds myself. Great throw, buddy. You got close. Give it another try.
Oh,
Where'd that second grenade go?
I think he dropped it.
Did he pull the pin?
Cover you.
I was happy when the corporal ran out of bullets. Surely now he was going to give up.
Kirby, I think I can get a grenade in there.
Okay, but be careful. I don't want to lose anyone else. Be extra careful.
I was almost hysterical with fear. I had never before seen killing up close like this. The young American showed a bravery and foolishness when he took on the German corporal all by himself. What happened next would haunt my dreams for years to come. Were fighting each other, I was confused. I was conflicted. I did not know, how do the Americans say it? Oh yes, I did not know who to root for.
Don't shoot me. I surrender to you, please.
I was never able to find his real name. Everyone just called him Fearless, another Australian soldier who was by far the most enterprising of the group. His ability to speak German earned him a prestigious job as an interpreter with the US 101st Airborne Division. Fearless was the first Allied soldier to climb to Hitler's bombed-out Alpine fortress. This was where Hitler spent most of his time. Much of the complex was still intact. Fearless actually took this film of one of his friends entering the room of Eva Braun, where she kept many of her valuables. Like her friend, Reich Marshal Göring, Eva Braun also kept an extensive collection of stolen works of art. Before long, with the help of some willing Confederates, Fearless was organizing the wholesale theft of Nazi treasures. They stole everything that wasn't nailed down. Fearless employed a combination of Aussie charm and bribery to get things done. His audacity knew no limits. He was able to organize convoys of US Army trucks to transport his stolen cargo to waiting naval ships. These then ferried the stolen cargo back to friendly ports, where he'd sell it off to the highest bidder. Several top-ranking American officers, who wanted much of the prized Nazi booty for themselves, grew suspicious and ordered all of Hitler's holdings to be guarded by military police. Then, when Hitler's personal photo album and silverware collection went missing, the top brass were furious. Fearless's pièce de résistance came when an entire shipload of exotic vehicles went missing, including Adolf Hitler's personal bulletproof limousine, which turned up on the docks of Fearless's hometown in Sydney. Of course, by then, he had gone too far. His goose was cooked. Or how do the Aussies say it? He was like the rope run on the Barbie. I learned these things only after the war, of course. I feel so bad about how it ended.
Don't shoot me. I give up. I surrender to you, please. I like America.
About stabbing the young soldier. I really did. It was an instinctive reaction. I didn't really think. But what the German corporal did next really shocked me. Instead of comforting me after saving his life, his first instinct was his own survival. I stood there as he rifled through the clothes of the young man's lifeless body. He was so cold about it. What are you doing?
There are important things in the bakery out there. I have to make sure the Americans don't find them.
Check the truck. I'll be right behind you.
What about the crowd, Sarge? What are we looking for, Sarge? Hey, Sarge, look what I found. This has to be worth a fortune.
It is, Rodney. It is worth a fortune.
We're all rich, Sarge.
Sorry, buddy.
No!
Bastard. This is what you were up to. We couldn't wait for backup.
Come on, Kirby, come on. There's enough for everyone. Be reasonable.
You'll be caught in my...
Despite everything, it was a good sign when the corporal was burning the documents. The general is dead. This meant the corporal was about to try and make his escape. At this point, I just wanted him gone, and for this nightmare to end.
Looks like it's all over. They finally got those trouts. Come on, let me help you up. Come on now.
You can get away now if you hurry. There only appears to be two of them left.
Go into the house.
Do not kill them. They are unarmed. Do not kill them, I beg of you. how things turn out, yeah? The Allies awarded me the Bronze Star for saving those two American soldiers. The French even gave me their highest military medal, the Croix de Guerre. I ended up being celebrated like a war hero.
Let's misbehave.
I could not believe it. When I got to meet Winston Churchill and the royal family at the Buckingham Palace, it was so exciting.
Let's misbehave.
9 months later, I gave birth to the German corporal's baby son. He was such a big boy. And he grew up to be just like his father. And who would have thought it? He went on to be a big star on the television. Many years later, when I was much older, a BBC television reporter came to interview me at my chalet in Monte Carlo. They were always wanting to ask me the same old thing. They wanted to know about the missing gold the Germans had stolen. That is when I would like to quote my son from the TV show. I would always answer them by saying, I know nothing, nothing.
Sadly, my mother passed away when she was 52 and she never got to see the movie. Also, she never got to see her two grandchildren, but here they are.